WHO, Dr. Halfdan Mahler was the director general, and Dr. Halfdan Mahler had called this pharmaceuticalization as neo-colonialism. So here we have Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, homeopathy in our country, of which we do not have 15 minutes exposure in our entire medical education. I did my MD in medicine, not even 15 minutes, forget, not even 10 minutes. So as we are ignorant, arrogant, that's the way we turn out, look down on what we had, we have no idea about it. So, and then you have the pharma companies whining and dining and all that kind of thing. So the seduction bit that was talked about earlier, that the medical profession and the scientific community and the whole clinical research and everything that is happening is basically to expand the market. And we're again coming to the WHO, even though Dr. Halfdan Mahler was there and he said he felt very strongly that this was neo-colonialism, and there was a international conference of experts on rational use of drugs in Nairobi, where many people felt that the developing countries are getting a raw deal by these companies. And after this, a resolution was made, which came in the World Health Assembly in 1986. US threatened to walk out of WHO if a strong resolution on rational use of drugs come. And then we say, why, who would want irrational use of drugs? And rational use of drugs and WHO supposed to deal with it? If WHO cannot ensure, and this is a resolution, is not even ensuring, it's just a resolution, and US is getting so uppity. Now, then one realizes that the policies, the state policies, are very much in, supporting the big pharma and the corporations, and the Heritage Foundation and all basically were there. This was in 86. And then, of course, by 88, the Uruguay round comes along, and then you have the GATT, and then by 1991, India has the new economic policy, and 1995, we have the WTO and trade-related intellectual property rights. And if one remembers that the treatment of with antiretroviral was $15,000 per year with the drugs of the patent holder of US. And it was only Indian generic equivalents, when Cipla and all, and Dr. Hamid, whose father was a freedom fighter, that $350 per year they could make the drug. They took it on as a challenge. And this is the big pharma did not like one bit. And so when South African government wanted as a compulsory licensing and parallel import, basically, to make antiretroviral drugs available to their people, 40 pharmaceutical companies took South African government to court. And this is when Dr. Mandela, Nelson Mandela has just, apartheid is over, and he takes on, he's the president, his government, they sue. So it became very, very clear that they don't give a, I can't say that much, sorry. if people die, it really doesn't matter, as long as they're making their profits. But one thing good that happened is people got really irritated, because health activists, consumer activists, AIDS activists, they said this is absolutely nonsense. This is an international trade regime, which is unjust. And again, lot of protests, and then you had the Doha, declaration of TRIPS and public health. I'm just mentioning these things because we thought, okay, now public health should get priority. And, many people felt that, okay, now we got it. But of course not. They have put pressure for TRIPS Plus, which is beyond what was signed. And the people who had drawn all up those were basically the corporations pushed through their government. And it has the pressure on Thailand, pressure on other governments. so that you cannot use the few flexibilities like, which is, you know, like parallel imports that you can buy from another country which is making generic equivalents, or use of compulsory licensing, which US is using itself, but not letting other countries use. There is a Commission on Intellectual Property Rights, Innovation and Public Health, WHO. This commission was formed, and I think it was in 2005 or 6, this report was released. But they will not let it be implemented. And now, the last year, and I just want to come, what are the newer forms of trying to control, is including the patent issue in the definition of counterfeit. We see counterfeit as adulterated, contaminated, as a public health issue. But bringing in the issue of patent in the definition of counterfeit, 14 ships have been seized in carrying Indian drugs. Generic equivalent, totally legal, because they said they were counterfeit. So what is this new definition of counterfeit? So European Union, like, basically is only supporting, recognizing the original patent holder as the legitimate and everybody else as illegal and counterfeit, which is basically cheaper generic drugs, and 80 to 90% of the antiretroviral drugs in the developing countries and by UNAIDS, etc., are basically, a lot of them are made in India. So and if they have, these countries have to buy from the original, which are many, many times more. So it's a public health issue of access to medicine. It's a issue of justice, because they said they also have a right to health. They have a right to medicine. They have a right to survive. It's a right to life. So not only they have seized this, there's a new thing that has been formed. Not very new, but, you know, last few years. It's called International Medical Products Anti-Counterfeiting Task Force, which has been formed by these pharma companies, squeezed into WHO, and they're using the WHO logo to push this, you know, what I'm calling the counterfeit agenda. But the general public see counterfeit as, you know, fake drugs and all, and so they feel, yes, you should take action against counterfeit. But actually, this is basically something which is being done by the big pharma company, supported by the government. And there's another thing that they are forming, and which is being done by US, EU, Japan, and I think Singapore is also involved. Slightly, you know, others are not involved, and this is formation of ACTA, which is anti-counterfeit trade agreement. They are formulating it, and they're going to squeeze it down our throats, and it's much harsher than what we have. And people do not realize that non-availability of medicine, again going back to comprehensive primary health care, it is preventive, promotive, curative, rehabilitative, all components, physical, mental, social, ecological, also spiritual, all dimension. Here they're picking only on curative, and even in curative will not allow curative, will not allow rational use of drug. So and who is doing the entire bullying is those countries which have these big dads, and whose profits have to be maintained at any cost, and the international unjust international regimes have to be made, then bullied, the nations have to be bullied, like we were bullied into changing Indian Patent Act of 1970, which was a good act, and which UNCTAD said was basically, you know, balance between public interest and the rights of the inventor. Both balance. This was, now we've changed into 20 years from process patent to product patent. Anyway, the long and short of it is that Ranbaxy, these are few of the important companies in our thing who were doing a little bit of research, have been bought over. So Ranbaxy is now Daiichi, being bought over by Daiichi. one after another. Abbott has bought Piramal. Huh? Shanta Biochemic, which is making vaccines, being bought over by Sanofi Aventis. So they're doing two things. One is to ensure that you cannot make generic equivalent drugs available. Number two, all those big companies that had possibility of making, you buy them. So this coming scenario is going to be extremely harsh. And what is happening, that those who are dealing in health and medicine, because they've given them funds for HIV, or given funds for reproductive health, or funds for something little bit micronutrient, not nutrition, not food. Huh? And so many of the NGOs and all have got very busy with the little projects of 2 years and 3 years. And the control on this is not only at this level. The issue, medical education, where medical education is concerned, we've been very proud of our medical education. We've had, you know, mainly government institutions and a public sector, few private. Now, a new thing, Mr. Kapil Sibal, who was earlier science and technology minister, now he's the education minister, but he's interested in higher education. He's not interested in primary education. And you don't have to wonder why, huh? Because as was being said, that education is being used to control, because the people who come out will be in the positions and then they become your tools. And Macaulay had said earlier in UK, I believe, there is some document lying that you have to get the Indians to look down on the heritage and all that has been theirs. Then only they will accept whatever you dish out to them. And so this thing about looking down on your, whatever is your health heritage, looking down on everything and on one hand. And number two, accepting lock, stock and barrel, things which come very seductively. So the medical education, they're opening firms, allowing firms to open medical colleges. There's a new foreign universities bill that is getting passed. There's a national council for higher education and research. Please note research, because innovation, intellectual property rights are linked to that. And in which dental, medical and agriculture all to be brought in. When we got the new economic policy in 1991, the economic policy document had American spellings. We were colonized, our spellings are British, Queen's English. And many of these documents that are coming up, I don't know if you remember, after the Uruguay round, when the whole this thing was signed, the GATTCA thing became WTO, and there's a cartoon, Mr. Manmohan Singh, who's our prime minister, usually wears a blue turban. There was this picture of his hand twisted many times like that, and leg twisted. And the cartoon said, when we go back, we will tell them we did it ourselves. So the question is, the autonomous so-called liberalization that is taking place is far beyond. So like, we are supposed to bend this much, and there are many people who don't want to bend, and the people in the power are bending three times. The closure of the three public sector units to produce vaccines, essential vaccines, is just one example. Then you buy from the private sector at double the cost, 100 times, 100% more. Then you there's push for a pentavalent vaccine, which is HIB, which is not required, but which will shoot up the prices, which only big dads make. So one sees how things are used, how influences are used. There's a push for rotavirus vaccine, and those who know about rotavirus mutates. Rotavirus strains, if you make some vaccine, you have to keep on changing the vaccine. We need clean drinking water. Homemade oral rehydration solution was the greatest medical revolution of the century. Homemade ORS has been removed from training manuals. And we've seen David Werner's book on questioning the solution. It was about Why this is to be removed? Because you want to sell packets. Now packets are not enough. Now you want to sell zinc tablets and rotavirus vaccine.